Welcome to the Andy Stanley Leadership Podcast Reverb, a conversation that digs deeper into this month's podcast topic, all designed to help leaders go even further, faster. I'm Susie Gray, and I'll be your host. This month, we're talking about our conversation with David Roberts last week on the topic of evolving your leadership competencies.
Yes, last week we got to talk to him, and now you and I get to talk about him.
It's the best part.
It is. But we warned him. We said, David, next week, But this is going to be great because it was such a great conversation.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, it was very interesting because, as you mentioned on the podcast last week, we've known David for a very long time.
Yep.
And, you know, have just watched his career over the years. And the reason that we ended up inviting him on the podcast was we read an article that he wrote for Forbes. And it struck me as a topic that we really haven't discussed directly on the podcast, but it was interesting to me because his comments on clarity in particular is something that I know is important to you, especially in uncertain times.
Yeah. Well, before we jump into clarity, I just want to backtrack a little bit because I didn't want to keep interrupting David last week. And for those of you who didn't listen to that conversation, you need to go back and listen because, to your point, Susie, it was a topic we've never talked about before. We talk about leadership philosophy. But David talked about the particular disciplines he's developed to maintain his leadership philosophy because a healthy leadership philosophy, while it may be intuitive once you hear it, they're generally not intuitively internally.
Right.
And so David was wise enough to realize, okay, if I'm really going to lead from the vantage point of servant leadership, which everybody talks about and has written about, and it's not new, and I'm not discounting it, it's extraordinarily important. It's one thing to say I'm committed to servant leadership, but we are not intuitively others-centered. We are self-centered. So David realized that and said, okay, so what are the disciplines I need to have personally to ensure that I don't just talk about it, talk to other leaders about it and try to inspire people to it, but to actually do it. I just thought it was fantastic. And even if our listeners didn't take away the specific disciplines he's created for himself, it was just a reminder to all of us, if we don't have those internal red flags and those internal measures, we're just going to become self-centered, what's in it for me, leaders. Nobody wants to work for one, and none of us really want to be one. So I just thought the topic in general was fantastic. So anyway, back to your question. So one of his disciplines was to constantly come back to the question of, am I being clear? Am I being clear? Mm-hmm. And then we talked about the discipline, and it was convicting to me. But as I shared last week, I was last week of a situation where I was frustrated because people didn't understand what I'd said 10 times, and obviously it's their fault, right?
Must be.
It must be, because people tell me I'm a great communicator, so how could it possibly—
How could you possibly not understand me?
How could I possibly not be clear?
Yeah.
But so he has decided clarity is a discipline for him, and when it appears to be unclear, he owns that.
Mm-hmm.
And it is absolutely incredible. And as we've talked about before, clarity is important because in times of uncertainty, in this moment, right?
Yeah,
political
right
uncertainty, social uncertainty, economic uncertainty. And so during times of disruption and uncertainty, people crave certainty because there's uncertainty. The problem is, as leaders, we can't provide certainty. Certainty is beyond our control because certainty is in the realm we have no control over, which is the future. We can promise it. In fact, you know, speaking of politics, we are moving into a season where many people are going to promise us certainty because that's how you get elected. And you can promise it all day long, but you can't guarantee it because, again, it has to do with the future. So while you have to promise it to get elected, you can't lead from that vantage point. But the next best thing to certainty is, as David pointed out, it's clarity. Mm-hmm. As long as people know we have a plan, as long as we are able to give people something to do that's going to get them or hopefully get them to a desired outcome, that's generally enough. That's as much certainty as we can provide. So again, when he talked about the disciplines he has internally to ensure that he remains a servant leader, he knows that one of the best ways, and this is so important, one of the best ways to serve the people we lead is to provide clarity, because clarity is a gift.
Yeah, we say all the time on our team, clear is kind.
Yeah,
when you're clear, it is kindness.
Yep.
Because sometimes people just want to know, you see what they see.
Yep.
Yes, I see that too. We may not have the exact answer right now,
yeah, yeah.
But it's empathy. And it's sometimes they can go, okay, they at least see it, and I know they're thinking about it.
Yeah.
And sometimes that is even enough.
Well, if I know you feel what I feel, mm-hmm. that's enough. Even if you right. can't solve my problem or resolve the tension I feel, to know that, oh, okay, they don't think I'm crazy. They don't think I'm a whiner. They don't think I'm a complainer. That's like, they get it.
They see it.
And when you're the leader and you communicate that, you're also communicating, not only do I see it, I'm taking responsibility for it, because ultimately, I'm the leader. I'm responsible for everything that happens in this organization. So the gift of clarity is an expression of servant leadership. And whereas I can't control whether or not people feel like I'm a servant leader, I can control whether or not I'm clear. And that's the value of these disciplines as it relates to a leadership strategy. So again, even though we've talked about clarity before, seeing it as a tool within the broader context of leadership strategy, I just thought it was so great.
Yeah, and it's so important because, I mean, uncertainty is literally just a part of leadership. It's a part of our lives.
It's why there are leaders.
Yes, yes, because there's not, if we all knew exactly what to do, yeah. let's go do it.
Right, exactly,
yeah.
exactly.
Yeah. Well, another thing David talked about is borrowing from your mentors. And he mentioned a mentor in particular that really taught him something early on that has become part of kind of his template that he talks about in his organization. And it was the four F's of leadership, he called it. Be fair, firm, friendly, but not too familiar. And I know mentors have played a really big part in your life. And I know people like Charlie Renfro have been instrumental in your leadership. And I wanted to know if there is anything that stands out as it relates to mentors.
Well, a couple things. First, I just think it's great that David was willing. I mean, he's leading a $3 billion right. international company. Mm-hmm. So obviously he's very bright. It would be easy for him to feel like, oh, I'm the person that has to come up with all the pithy statements
all the
and all the successories, all that stuff. But the fact that he would, in fact, he said he's repeated this so many times that everybody that works around him has heard it, like roll their eyes. He said it so much, but he was quick to give credit. In other words, I didn't originate this. I've brought this with me mm-hmm. from the time I was leading nobody but myself to right. the point that I'm leading this organization. So bringing along the learnings from the past, especially from our mentors, and giving our mentors credit, whether it's something we've read, many people have been mentored through the books and articles of specific leaders and others personally, I thought that was great. But yeah, so my first mentor was Charlie Renfro, who I've talked about all the time, and you know Charlie, mm-hmm. and we're still dear friends.
Yeah, we actually had him on the podcast.
That's right, and I'm sure many of our podcast listeners remember that episode because there's so many Charlie-isms, right? That again, and I'm quick to give him credit. One of the first things he taught me was make sure you open the cage for the 500-pound gorilla and invite him into the room, which means you don't hide from problems, you don't run from problems, you don't avoid problems. If there's an issue, if there's a thing, if there's a beast, you just invite it into the room and you deal with it because problems don't solve themselves. You don't run from them. And he shared that with me at a time in my life when my tendency was to avoid someone because I didn't want to deal with the stuff of the someone, and it was someone at work. Another Charlie-ism was don't create a new problem by trying to solve an old problem that can't be solved. I mean, there are some things that can't be solved. You spend too much time trying to solve those, you're going to create a new problem. And then, you know, the big takeaway for me as I when I thought about his life story that, again, has headed me off of the past so many times was family first, money second. Family first, money second. And, of course, he went on to make a lot of money because he's smart and super successful. But, you know, his life story was there was a pivotal moment where he decided family first. And again, when you bring those lessons forward. So I quote Charlie all the time.
So
for our podcast listeners, the takeaway is those early lessons that we learned maybe from our parents, one of our parents, maybe a grandparent, a neighbor, a coach from high school, those early lessons, those truisms, bringing those forward and keeping those front and center, they are generally always true and always helpful. And carrying those forward is a huge part of servant leadership. Because generally speaking, someone who chose to mentor us, there was no advantage to them.
Yeah, no benefit to them.
No, I mean, Charlie wouldn't even let me buy him breakfast. You know, he bought breakfast and mentored me.
Right.
So again, that's servant leadership. I'm going to give you what has been given to me that's timeless for you to take forward into your own career. So again, this was part of servant leadership.
And I think it's so important when you think about mentors to always have somebody that has permission to speak into those areas of your life and, you know, to constantly look at, you know, who has that space in my life right now.
Yep.
Because, you know, mentors sometimes come along you for a season, but like with David, this mentor that came alongside of him years ago, he's carried forward. But I know he still has mentors in his life. And I think that's another really important point, Susie, is that discipline.
This is something you're great at. You,
because I need people.
Well, I don't know that you do, but you have been so great about seeking those people out. And then you come to meetings and you quote, and I'm like, when did you talk to her? When did, and you have initiated those conversations, and you're a better leader for it and richer for it. And we all are, because you bring that content into our conversations and into our organization. So way to go.
Yeah, I've been very lucky to have some great people over the years and still do. So it's really super. Well, so final question. Andy, as you think about your leadership philosophy and the way that you keep yourself between the guardrails in your own leadership practice, what stands out that, hey, this is something I've learned I have to do, and it's really kept me in the sweet spot of my leadership philosophy?
Well, for those that listened to last week's episode, I talked about a couple of them because they were similar to David's in terms of the similar struggles we have, towards self-centeredness and not being clear or blaming or getting out of our competency zone because, you know, something's drawn us out, you know, unnecessarily. But one of the other ones for me, and this goes back to a question that I heard a leader ask this question. It wasn't even the theme of a talk. It was just part of almost a conversational part of a leadership speech he was giving, that I walked away with this question: what would a great leader do? Yeah. What would a great leader do? What would a really great leader do? And the context is, in the midst of decision making, for me, when I'm a little bit too amped up and geared up around something I'm frustrated about or angry about, or why did she or why did he or why did they or why doesn't it? And I'm tempted to power up and be selfish sometimes to say, okay, you know, as you're evaluating the options, at least put this into the mix, Andy. What would a great leader do? And I like the word great, because if you ask people, describe a great leader, they're immediately going to go to character, selflessness, others first.
They have an answer immediately.
What's best for the organization, you know, sacrifice personally in order to, you know, for the sake of other people. We just know that. Right. It's intuitive. So instead of what would a selfless leader do, or, you know, no, what would a great, because, you know, I want to be selfless, but this question appeals to my ego.
Yeah.
I want to be
a great
leader.
Yeah.
But I want to be a great leader the way that we know greatness truly is, means it's not about me. Mm-hmm. It's about the organization. It's about the people in the organization. So that's one of my, okay, you're about to walk in there. You're about to say, but is that what a great leader would do? Is this how a great leader would respond? Is that, would a great leader send that email? Would a great leader send an email instead of waiting till tomorrow, walking down the hall and having a conversation? Would a great leader require them to come to your office, or would you just go to their, you know, pause and at least consider? And goodness, that question so many times just kept me between the rails.
And the great thing about that question is it takes the energy out of the decision.
Like
the emotion goes away when you're like, okay, but what? What if I actually stopped and considered this?
It goes back to what we just talked about. Suddenly there is clarity.
Clarity.
Terrifying clarity.
The demand something from you, clarity.
Yes, exactly. I can't do what I want to do. But at the end of the day, you look back and you're like, wow.
So glad.
So glad.
Yeah.
I want to work with great leaders, I want to work for a great leader, and I want to be a great leader the way that, you know, great should be defined.
Yeah, for sure. Well, Andy, that is all the time we have for this episode of Reverb. Thanks so much for digging deeper into the topic of evolving your leadership competencies and providing a few more insights. And to all of our listeners, we want to thank you for joining us. Be sure to visit andystanley.com/podcast, where you'll find many more resources to help you go further, faster.